more airfield when a plane comes in to land. It's part of the standard drill for dealing with the danger of fire. And as long as there is this hazard in aviation, firefighting equipment must be of the highest possible efficiency. These standards have been achieved in the Mark I dual-purpose fire tender made by Fomite Limited, a member of the Tekalimit Group at Plymouth. These tenders were designed and built under contract to the Ministry of Supply. It was one of the biggest post-war contracts for this type of vehicle, 186 of them, with a delivery schedule of one every 2 days. This production rate was attained by applying big-scale engineering workshop techniques to a specialized job of bodybuilding to ensure dimensional accuracy and interchangeability of parts. This involved using 20 main jigs and 42 sub-assemblies, or 4,000 pieces for each tender or pigeonhole ready for use. It is of major importance that each part is a perfect fit. When the component has been carefully tapped into place, it is then clapped down in the jigs prior to being welded. This is the framework of the cab roof in process of being assembled. The largest number of component parts are in the cab roof and they fit easily into place in the roof jig. When all the final roof parts have been fitted into place, the framework is then ready for the next step in the assembly line, and here it is, the welding. The assembly of this roof is one of the most difficult jobs of the whole operation because of the combination of angles implicit in its design. Yet when the assembly is completed and removed from the jig, it must be dimensionally accurate and completely free from all distortion. Here's the step assembly being fitted to the chassis of the jig, and very special attention must be given to the locating points. Then the front framework is added to the jig chassis, where once again, locating pins are an essential for interchangeability. Next comes the roof of the cab, which is now being fitted onto the cab frame. This method of jigging emphasizes and ensures the interchangeable character of the sides, tops, bulkheads, and so on. And the ability to do this is an important condition of the contract upon which the Minister of Supply insists. This interchangeability means a great saving both of time and money when it comes to replacing any one section which may have been damaged. Spares can be flown quickly to any part of the world where these tenders are operating. And again, this is another section being fitted to the mobile jig. This time, one of the side frames for the main body of the tender. When sections of framework have to be skinned with light aluminium sheet, care with the drilling and riveting has to be constantly exercised, as in the case of this bulkhead. After skinning and riveting, the panel is then fitted to the rear end of the tender. At this stage, the whole skeleton structure of the body of the tender is then moved from the heavy fabrication shop into the main assembly shop. The It's still on the mobile jig, and it won't leave that jig until the framework is completely skinned. Also at this stage, as much work as possible is done on the interior of the body. Sheet aluminium, already marked and scribed, is accurately cut to pattern by an electric cutting tool. These sections are then fitted and riveted to the sides and roof, and so, section by section, the body of the tender begins to take shape. Further ahead along the production line is another unit, well on the way towards completion before the final stage, when it's wedded to the Thornycroft Nubian chassis with its Rolls-Royce engine. Glass lining is used as an insulator against both excessive heat and cold. It not only protects the whole of the cab and the body, but also important components. But modern methods can never completely replace some of the old hand skills such as panel beating when it's required for special jobs of this type. Metal doming, for instance, calls for real craftsmanship which no machine can supply. This domed insert is then welded to the main section. The high spots are tapped down. And any remaining unevenness is finally smoothed down by filing. Equipment lockers being fitted, and like everything else in these tenders, they're interchangeable with any body. Easily accessible lockers house the air foam generating nozzles. There are two of these stowage lockers, one on either side of the vehicle, and below them are stowage lockers for 600 feet of hose. Good visibility is all important in the driving cab of a fire tender. Mobility for the crew of five men is also an all-important factor. These carefully fitted jackknife doors may well save precious seconds in getting to grips with a fire. And this is the pump compartment, fitted with equipment capable of producing 3,600 gallons of foam a minute. In the meantime, the chassis is waiting for its body, cab, and tanks. An aeronautical inspection department representative checks these mounting brackets. They must be dead flat and perfectly square. If they're not, the whole structure may be inaccurate. And after being passed by the AID inspector, here is a tank bracket being mounted. Brackets have been bolted into place, the completed cab is raised and the chassis rolled into position beneath it. Now comes the crucial test of the whole production operation as the prefabricated cab is lowered gently onto the chassis. Note how these lining up bolts fit snugly into their housing without the slightest trouble. That's the test, and it's a triumph of meticulous planning and craftsmanship. The Coventry Climax pump unit is the next piece of equipment to be fitted, and this is bolted on the rear end of the chassis. The chassis is then slowly backed into position under the hoist, and the main body of the tender is then gently lowered into position. Every step along the production line has been perfect. This body should be lowered and bolted and locked inside 20 minutes. And it is. It's another first-class example of precision work. The tank fitted to this Mark I dual-purpose Fomite tender is capable of holding 100 gallons of water, and it's specially lagged with fiberglass covered with canvas. This insulation is a safeguard against low temperatures. Some of these tenders will be used under conditions of extreme cold, and water tanks must be protected against freezing. As the bottom of the tank frame settles into position, it slips easily over the locating bolts without damaging the threads. Another example of refinement is the fitting of a safety grab rail in this well-designed and spacious driving cab. Now come the final stages. The job's done, the tender's ready for service. And when the Fomite Works team has finally finished its assembly of the tender, the vehicle is handed over to the Aeronautical Inspection Department for thorough checking and final acceptance tests. Pump housing has been examined, the tender then has to go away for outside tests. Most important of the outside tests is to check the efficiency of the pumping equipment. The suction hose is being fitted to draw water from the static water tank. Two delivery hoses are connected to the water discharge outlets. Here you see the operation of the truck as it supplies water to four of the air foam generating nozzles to give a maximum production of foam. This is a test with water only, however, and it's a long duration test. And with all the tests completed to the satisfaction of the Aeronautical Inspection Department, yet another Mark I dual-purpose fire tender moves off from the Tekalimit factory at Plymouth, ready to go into service with the Royal Air Force at stations in any part of the world. But the production experience gained by Fomite Limited in successfully carrying out this big contract will not be confined to service requirements alone. All this specialized knowledge in the development of firefighting equipment is being made available to civil aviation authorities or to anybody in any sphere of activity where fire hazards exist. And with the solid backing of highly successful production experience now behind it, Fomite Limited is ready to design and build fire tenders to meet the local needs and requirements of purchasers in any part of the world.